redzēt šeit tik uplā skaitā.
Good morning, I am happy to see so many of you here. I will tell about what this directive will mean in Latvia. And to do that, I will try to answer three questions. First, to whom the directive will apply? Why it will affect a larger range of companies and how it will affect other companies via contracts, including small, medium and large companies. Of course, currently we don't know what will be the final edition, if it ever is agreed about, but I read as a version that was adopted as a result of political agreement in December, and according to this text, this directive will apply to four types of companies, large companies who have more than 500 employees, and the global net turnover exceeds 150 million euros. The next group of companies will be the main company in a group of companies that meets the same requirements. The third group are companies with a franchise or licensing business model, like Narvesen, for example. These small kiosks are not daughter companies of one large company. They more act like independent companies, but they use the same brand and the same assortment of goods. And these companies will also be in the remit of the directive if the franchise payments will be higher than 7.5 million euros and the total net turnover will be higher than 40 million euros. And the next group companies with more than 250 employees and global net turnover higher than 40 million euros if they are from one of the high-risk sectors like textiles, agriculture, food and beverage, forestry, mining, and so on. In Latvia, that would also apply to peat production companies, which would be considered high-risk sectors, also metal, working, and also construction. Gabriel already mentioned that the directive will affect companies beyond the European Union, but that these requirements will apply also not only in Europe, but also beyond EU. I don't know if the directive will be applied this year or not this year, and we don't know yet to which companies this directive will apply eventually, but I believe that the idea will be that initially it will apply to larger companies and then it will trickle down. So, if we think about what these companies could be in Latvia and how many of them we have in Latvia, they're actually very few, less than 1%. But does it mean that we have to pay less attention to this initiative? Probably not. Because in the EU, the situation is very similar. They have less than 1% of companies that will be in the scope of this directive. And this is the logics behind the Commission proposal. They looked at the situation, for example, in Germany and in France, where there was this intention to apply the due diligence only to the largest companies. And why will this directive affect a larger range of companies? It is important to understand how companies may be linked with negative impacts. And if we look at the UN principles, the negative effects can be of three types. First, the negative impact that the company creates itself. As Martin said, for example, that would result from inadequate safety standards, someone is injured, or, for example, employees of the company discriminate against a specific group of customers.
Un tas ir, piemēram, tādos gadījumos, kad
The next case could be when the company contributes to negative impact, for example, when there are short delivery times or there are changes at the very last moment, and the supplier is forced basically to violate occupational safety standards, ask employees to work overtime, excessive overtime or unpaid overtime, and this results in this negative impact. And the third group, negative impacts are not facilitated, but they are directly related with the operation goods and services of a company due to business relationships. For example, something is ordered from a contractor or a subcontractor is engaged, and the subcontractor is engaged, for example, in forced labor, then there is this link. Or another example, for example, last summer we had in the news these cases that someone with a service dog was not allowed into an air Baltic plane. And it was actually not due to air Baltic, because they didn't make this choice. It was made by their cooperation partner, but still the air Baltic was criticized. So we are speaking about value chains. And many of you probably will know what is a value chain, but in brief, it's an upwards chain. Basically, it's a supply chain, production of raw materials, production of components, delivery to further stages in this process, and then the downward value chain, eventually reaching the end user, and also what happens with the goods after the end of their useful life. Here I have gaps, because we are speaking about value chains in the context of UN sustainability principles, also the sustainability directive. But what concerns the directive that I was invited to speak about, we speak about operational chains, and here I have the gap that represents those links of the chains that are not covered by the directive. And the most serious, probably, defect is that the directive will not cover the impacts that result from the use of goods and services of a specific company. Does it mean that the company doesn't have to think about it? No, it still has to be reported, that, and most probably the company will not be able to claim that we did not assess this impact because the directive didn't ask us to do that. Probably it could be linked with the civil responsibility or liability mechanism, and maybe just conclude that maybe this particular link or stage in the chain will not be subject to the directive. Here we also have to try to think about in which parts of the chain Latvian companies could be and how negative impacts could be created in this way. When we think about how this directive will affect other companies, it's important to highlight that the directive will not have a direct obligation for small and medium-sized companies and companies that are not in its scope, but the directive would still impose specific requirements onto companies that are in its scope when they cooperate with these small and medium-sized companies. First, these large companies have to have a code of conduct, and they have to make sure that their cooperation partners comply with this code, and just a simple commitment will not be enough. It will not be enough just to promise that we will comply with human rights requirements and your code and whatever. In addition, you will have to ensure adequate and efficient measures to make sure that they comply, for example, independent third-party checks, participation in multi-party initiatives, certification, for example. But the most important aspect is that these measures should be effective. According to the directive, these large companies will have to support smaller companies either by making financial contribution or providing training on human rights or maybe investment in management systems. And then, of course, the large companies will also have to improve their practices. Because, as I mentioned, sometimes the operations of the company can cause negative effects resulting from other companies. And the final measure could be the termination of cooperation. I will tell about logic behind this, because historically there have been cases when a company or organization has found significant human rights violations in a specific company, and then the partners decide to leave the market or leave this company. This sometimes is not so good for the employees working for this violating company, because when the vendor or supplier loses many of its customers, employees cannot receive salaries, and there is a much, much larger negative impact due to this decision to terminate the relationship. So when there is really a violation, first and foremost, we expect that the company will engage to make sure that this situation can be rectified, and when constructive engagement cannot deliver a positive result, only then it is worth starting to think that maybe termination is a good option. And think about how this could be included in agreements between various parties. It is important that along directive, the European Commission will adopt standard clauses. Meanwhile, we can look at the US practice, because they already have supplier standard clauses, and in Europe also there is an independent expert group working on the same type of clauses. In Germany there is already a body that monitors the local laws and compliance with the laws. It's called BAFA, and they issue various recommendations to companies, not only in German but also in English and in French, and then it's also worth looking at these documents. The main conclusion is that when you read these documents, I would like to use other opportunity to tell more about these documents, but the main point here is that the agreements should be made in a way to manage not only business risks, but also human rights risks. Thank you. That's all from me today, and I'll be happy to answer your questions during the coffee break.